Hello and welcome to Argument Podcast. It's a platform to discuss, deliberate and debate on several social, legal and political issues. It's been quite some time since we have had the podcast session. So looking forward to this particular session, in fact, and we are joined by Atul and also Advocate Aman Chaudhary. Sir is actually a new member of the podcast. So sir, before we proceed ahead, if you could just introduce yourself to the audience.
Okay, so hi everyone, and first of all, thank you for making me a part of this amazing series. So I am Advocate Aman Chaudhary. I am practicing in Delhi High Court and District Court, and apart from that, I'm also a sports lawyer that I provide consultancy to sports organization and sports athletes. So yeah, this was my brief introduction, and once again, I'm happy to be a part of the podcast and share my views and opinions and listen to the others also. Thank you for having me again.
Definitely, sir. So looking ahead with the issue at hand, and though on our TV screens we are having the issue of, you know, how the NDPS Act is eventually being used supposedly by the center very arbitrarily, but also considering the fact that how the issue of drug abuse has come into the limelight. So with this session in particular, how we are going to be moving ahead with regard to how it impacts on the legality and also how it's politically and socially impacting on the society at large as well. The NDPS Act came on the backdrop of the entire war on drugs issue, and that's the reason why it was required at that particular time and frame. But how far does the NDPS Act stands the test of time as such?
Okay, so this question actually has a two part. So NDPS Act was actually formed from the point of view of drug abuse, as you correctly said. So back in the time when the act was introduced, everyone was actually not aware about drugs and they were not taking them casually. Because to be honest, I'm saying it very bluntly that nowadays, people are taking drugs casually. But when the act was introduced, it was introduced with the intention of combating certain drug abuses, certain drug uses. And back at that time, no one actually thought of that the use is what I will be saying. The use of drugs would be so great in the nearer future. And secondly, it would be so essential. So NDPS Act was actually not thought of at that point of time because no one thought that the drug abuse would be graver in the future. And secondly, that the drugs would also be essential. So very interesting thing about drugs is that nowadays, even medicine that we use, that we buy from pharmacy, they are drugs. Okay. So why does there's an NDPS Act and there's Essential Commodities and Drugs Act? So these two acts need to be read together in order to understand what NDPS Act actually means. Because if we go on and saying that drugs are wrong, then drugs are not wrong. Because in the Essential Commodities Act and in the pharmacies, we are buying drugs with prescription and they are needed for us. So the NDPS Act was actually made with this mindset. But now coming to the second question, that does it fall on the test of time, and presently does it
because
actually... There's
a lot of controversy going around that why is the NDPS Act still being utilized, because even for small quantities of drugs as well, one is being tried for
exactly
a more rehabilitative version of it than going to jail and everything like that.
And this is a very interesting thing that recently the talks are going on with the central government that they are thinking of decriminalizing the small quantity one. So they are thinking of amending the NDPS Act and doing away with the small quantity, and then there would be only commercial quantity and less than commercial. So that would be a great step, and NDPS Act does need that particular thing. But if we see it on the other aspect of it, if we are legalizing drug use in small quantity in India, where there is lack of education, where there's lack of certain, you know, exposure. So would that be a great step, or would that be not be a great step? That is also is the thing that has to be looked into. So according to me, in the introductory part, like we'll be discussing more about it in the podcast, but in introductory sense, I just think that we need to find a middle ground. Like every one of us knows that there's been drug use highly in hill stations, some hill stations that are famous for consumption of drugs.
Definitely.
They're openly consuming, they're even selling. So when we talk about certain things, we are actually not considering them. Because if we have made a law and we are booking famous personalities, for example, Arya Khan or Surya Chakrabarty, then we also need to look into the aspects of common people who are taking drugs up in the hills. So we need to find
sorry to cut you, but a very funny anecdote is that Holi mein, we of course there is bhang which is consumed, right? Bhang is I think essentially a cannabis or a lot more diluted form from our
wrong. Exactly, yeah. And I'll tell you one thing. I happen to be in Jaisalmer, and there's this famous government recognized bhang shop in Jaisalmer. The government has given the license to sell bhang. So when we talk about these things, then there should be a middle ground where, like, I'm not saying that is wrong. Okay, that is completely right, because government is licensing and you are providing bhang. Bhang is easily available in around Holi, and many people consider it as an offering or prasad of Shivji. So I'm not going into that religious thing at all. It may be right, it may be wrong. That depends on people to people. But I'm saying that we need to find a middle ground for the NDPS Act also, the applicability of NDPS Act, because it does not say that the NDPS Act will only apply to rich people or to famous celebrities and not to common people. This is something which has come up from the procedural part of it.
Yeah. Okay. For the benefit of the audience and like to not just the legal luminaries or students as such, the NDPS Act is basically with regard to narcotic drugs. So the full form of NDPS is Narcotics Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act. So that is basically the intention was to actually try to curb the drug abuse. And unfortunately in India, and particularly in different states of our country, like be it in Punjab or be it in several border states wherein drugs are being used in a very irregulated form. So maybe in those particular situations wherein there's a strong need to curb the illegal trade of trade and possession of such drugs, that's where there are several punishment measures and also provisions with regard to what's the kind of quantity of each drug as such.
Yeah, I believe that, before starting that, adding on to Joy, I would love to say that about, I would love to talk about the origin of these drugs and their acts actually. So it was not the NDPS Act which was first brought down in India. So prior to that, we had acts such as the Opium Act of 1857, another Opium Act of 1878, which was rebroughten, and then the Dangerous Drugs Act of 1930, were enacted a long time ago. And then there are certain loopholes actually and many drawbacks into these. And so to curb all that, then the National Drugs and Psychotropic Substance Act of 1985 was brought in. And the basic objectives of this act, as Joel has stated before, is to consolidate and amend the law relating to narcotic drugs, to make stringent provisions for control and to regulate the operation of relating to narcotic drugs as well as psychotropic substances here within. So that was the thing. And then based on the legality, I think this act clearly defines what a narcotic substance is, in the legal sense. It is quite different from what it is written in the medical context, actually. And then legally, a narcotic drug could be an opiate, meaning a true narcotic, cannabis or cocaine, the very antithesis of a narcotic, since it's a stimulant. So the term the term psychotic substances denotes mind altering drugs, such as for example, it can change your mood, behavior, and thought. And there are examples as these can be the LSD drugs, lysergic acid, thalamide acid. Actually, that kind of example. So if you ask me on a proper definition of narcotic drugs in the medical sense, The word narcotic refers to the different types of substances which makes the sense of pain less effective, and it soothes the pain.
Basically, dopamine of sorts. Like basically, in order to stimulate yourself and release yourself of pain pressure and stuff. Like, into how effective these drugs can accordingly be to each human individual as such. So, like the question to the three of us is like, if there are other substances which can replace these kind of narcotic drugs in order to relax one's mind, how ethical or how legal is that? Or basically, even these drugs also have its own criteria with regard to how it's permissible or not, sir.
Okay, so that is actually a very interesting question, because what you said is ethically and morally. Okay, so if I talk about relaxing one's mind and if you're using certain things, so liquor is also something if it is used for relaxing our mind, and that is not illegal. The consumption of liquor is not illegal, except in some states, obviously. So if we talk about ethical and moral wrong in consuming anything which relaxes our mind, I think it depends from one person to the other, and mainly depends on the society also. So I would say that it's actually ethically, morally, and societally wrong. So these are three things that we need to see. If we are living in a society where people say that, you know, consumption of one thing is really bad, or if we come from a society where people say that you consume a certain bhang, for example, you consume it as an offering of Shivji. So that is something which may be ethically wrong, which may be morally wrong, but religiously or in the society, it's permitted. So according to me, it depends from one person to the other. And if there is any substitute for any illegal drug, then maybe if you're taking it, if it is legal, then okay. If you are ethically fine with it, if you are morally fine with it, then go ahead, consume it. And if also like the central government passes the amendment and they say that even the consumption of these drugs that are mentioned in the NDPS Act, if you're consuming it in small quantity, it would be legal. So I'm taking this as an hypothetical situation that coming down the line in 1 or 2 years, if this amendment passes, and you're taking small quantity drugs that are mentioned in the NDPS Act, then that's fine with the law. That's fine with India. So you need to make sure that ethically, if you're taking it, morally, if you're taking it, then okay, that's fine with everyone. So there's no harm in finding a substitute of something illegal. Till it is illegal, that is the main thing. Till it is legal, you can find it, and rest is up to you, up to your family, up to your society, whoever you think fit.
If we consider other countries as well, like for example, if you take the United States as such, there was that war on drugs, and they had the entire signatory with regard to fighting against narcotic drugs as such. But right now, you do have several states of the United States, you know, kind of on the borderline of legalizing them.
Some states have legalized drugs.
Yes, yes. So how far do you all see the application on state-wise consumption in India as such, or we still like it's a more centralized opinion of the same with regard to consumption in India, or is it possible to look at several models like what the US is doing as such with regard to state-wise regulation? We consume in a small quantity, it's absolutely permissible. So be it like chadas is 100 grams, cocaine is 2 grams, ganja is like 1 kg for small quantity, heroin, depending on each quantity as such. So how far do we see, if India could possibly allow states, or basically if India has a particular legislation on permitting state-wise regulation or use of drugs as such, similar to that of the United States?
Okay, so I think practically it would not be possible in India, because if we talk about drugs, then it's not just consumption. It's actually first, if I talk about the procedure, then first is the cultivation. How these drugs, if by cultivation, I'm not saying that they're grown, but how they're procured and everything that goes into the raw materials, how they are made. Then second thing, it comes, how it is transported, how it is made available to the people. And third and the last thing is the consumption. So these three aspects are different. And sometimes it happens that if we go on and make state legislations, then it would be exactly like what is happening with beef consumption, to be honest. So that would be the thing, that if a certain state goes on and says that we are only legalizing the cultivation of particular drug, but no one can consume it in our state. And why they are doing it? Because of the people, the livelihood of the people is dependent on that. For example, the villages of Malana, their livelihood is dependent on only charas, because they are in the farming of charas and they actually send it out, they export it. So if we see ideally, that is illegal. Okay, to be honest, that is illegal. But how are the state legislations doing there? What are the authorities doing there? They're kind of ignoring it. They're kind of making it legal. So if we say it in the practice, they're making it legal. So if we make up a law, for example, in the state of Himachal Pradesh, where they're saying that in Himachal Pradesh, we are allowing cultivation of charas and people can also consume it. So what would happen there is everyone would go there and make their business set up there. Okay, so that would be the core of livelihood of certain people, irrespective whether they belong to the village of Malana or not. So according to me, anything like this will not be feasible in the country of India, because after all, even if we have state legislations, there is something like the NDPS Act that governs in the central power. So we need to come up with something itself in the NDPS Act. And the first instance, as I said, would be the legalizing of small quantity. That is actually one step that we are taking forward, because people are being influenced by Western culture. They say that we are moving towards the 21st century concepts and we need to legalize certain drug use. So if we take all these things into account, we need to actually move towards a better, I would say a better NDPS Act instead of a small state legislation. This would be my opinion.
Yes, like also the argument might come that if certain states are only, like if such a law is applicable per state, maybe the states become too dependent on that kind of an economy. So example, if it comes to a point of having like a drug economy of sort, like that of what's disastrously happening in Afghanistan or other countries which are completely dependent on drugs with regard to their trade and also with regard to the economy as such. So such measures can also be counterproductive, is what you are getting to as well. Like with regard to small quantities might be an exception, but with regard to relying out economically, it may not be very, very feasible or very difficult to curtail as such.
Exactly. And if we talk about India, then we have examples of it, like liquor is banned in certain state, beef is banned in certain state. So we know the repercussions of it. We know what things are happening with trafficking of beef, trafficking of liquor, and certain organizations, or I would say certain state totally depending on that. So we have like living examples of it. So if we go on and do it something with more extensive thing than liquor and beef, that is drugs, then I think it would be actually more problematic in India.
All right. So the very reason why the discussion about the NDPS Act comes into play is also like we mentioned in the beginning of the session, it's also with regard to the recent Aryan Khan case, and also with regard to even last year as well, we heard about, you know, the unfortunate demise of Sushant Singh Rajput, and also the allegations on Riya Chakraborty with regard to the use of drugs as such. So the question to all is that has it come to a point that or figuratively, if you could say so, are certain cases being looked at a different perspective? Like, though with regard to the Aryan Khan case, one might say that the bail is, it's not that the offense is as grievous as such, because there was, like, supposedly there is no they couldn't find any drugs in him. Do you think that it's either the behavior of the lower courts and as to how they deal with such cases, is that one of the reasons why maybe bail is not being granted to him, or even be it to other personalities as well? So do you see it different in different courts as such?
Yeah, definitely. That is a very important issue. And I would say instead of differentiation, sometimes it's discrimination also. So like, but if we see, if you guys have seen NDPS Act, this section 35, it says presumption of culpable mental state. And it's actually the opposite of what we are reading in the criminal law. We are saying that every person is innocent until proven guilty. But NDPS Act goes it vice versa. It says every person who's there who's booked under the NDPS Act is guilty unless proven innocent. So actually the burden of proof is opposite. The burden of proof is on the defense to prove his innocence. Whereas in other criminal law, the burden of proof is actually on the prosecution. So that is very interesting to see in the NDPS Act. And actually this section 35 is the main, I would say, the evil in the drug or the drug proceedings of India. Because every person who is booked under NDPS Act, he is guilty. That is what our law says. And you have to prove your innocence. Now, how will a person prove his or her innocence? He is going to prove from the evidence point of view. So the basic reason of rejecting, for example, Aryan Khan's bail was actually 35, that we are treating him as guilty person. And you have to come up with the proofs. So it is discrimination, and a special treatment is given to certain people, like in the case for Aryan Khan. And that is because of their public image. Now, this is, I'm telling very clearly that in India, every legal case ends up a media trial. That is true. Okay. Everything that goes on in a court, directly or indirectly, will be there in a media trial. Now, when I'm saying media trial, I'm not only talking about news in the newspaper. You open up your newspaper and I guarantee you around 60% news are actually of certain offense, certain court proceedings, and you'll find High Court, Supreme Court, or District Court written. So anything being published in the newspaper is also kind of a media trial, because you're making people aware, but you're not making them aware of the entire legal thing. So they get the half-cooked, half-baked knowledge, and they end up discussing it with their fraternity or their friends, and this is how it goes on. So that is true that even the courts think about this particular media image. So I would use media image, not media trial. So they're concerned about.
So you think that the courts are like as per your, like, since you practice in the courts as well, do you feel that the courts also are pressurized or burdened with regard to the news of the same, like with regard to the how they handle the case as such?
I would not say burdened or pressurized, but I would say they are, like, not influenced also, but they're concerned. Concerned is the correct word. Because like right now, if we talk about example, the prime example is of Aryan Khan. People like NCB is doing its job, right? They're doing its job to the core of the act. How the act says they are doing each and everything. They've conducted raid, they are taking interrogations, then they're applying in the courts. But still, now people are going against NCB only. People are saying Aryan Khan is innocent. Why are you doing this? Because he is a famous celebrity. That's why you're going behind him. So this is the thing. Now, whatever NCB has done, still they end up being in a bad light, right? So every authority, like not court only, every authority in India, whether it's the judicial authority or the police authority or the procedural aspect of it, everyone is concerned about their own image, how they are showcased in the media. Okay, so they're concerned about it, and that is why they end up doing certain acts, they end up doing certain proceedings in a manner that may actually help their image. So that is the main thing that happens. And more important, when we talk about famous celebrities, the courts think that if we are portraying a particular celebrity in a particular manner, then how will it showcase to the other people? That all these famous celebrities, the courts and the authorities, they have their image that these particular celebrities have a fan following. They have their own brand image outside, like in a virtual world or outside these courts. So if we are doing something and we are giving certain benefit, I would say benefit or right to this particular person, then how would that would be portrayed outside? That is the main question that these people ask when they are even hearing the bail or when they are rejecting or accepting bail. So if I sit as a judge in an Aryan Khan case, then also I would be concerned about whatever I would say would make a great havoc outside. So I would be concerned. I would be thinking twice or thrice. Like if me or you were there instead of Aryan Khan, I would have just given, okay, bail accepted or bail rejected in one instance. Mm-hmm. But since it is Aryan Khan, son of famous Shah Rukh Khan, I would be thinking it twice, thrice, four times. And I would be giving dates and dates because I need to be sure. Otherwise, it would be a great havoc in the city. So that is the thing that, yes, a special treatment is given. And I think it's justified. Special treatment in the sense of application of mind, application of the judicial mind. That is what I'm saying, the special treatment. So I think it is acceptable. And yes, NDPS Act does discriminate and it needs major changes. It has many shortcomings. So yeah,
kind of a concern with regard to how the public perceives at large. And also considering that we have had so many celebrities who were on the wrong side of the law, or basically who are on the back foot with regard to the law. So if that's what you had meant, sir?
That was actually what I meant, because you see that even Sanjay Dutt. Okay, so Sanjay Dutt is a great example. People nowadays still follow him with that much great enthusiasm. And that's okay. That's their personal choice. So this is actually what I'm saying, that when we deal with celebrities, you need to actually be sure about their, you need to be concerned about their fans, their following, their brand image. Because trust me, it can do good also, but it can do bad also.
Mm-hmm.
So that is what actually I meant when the courts or the, for example, even the NCB, they actually deal with celebrities. So they need to be very sure about it. Because there would be n number of things associated when you are dealing with a celebrity.
Yeah.
Sir, I would like to ask about the same kind of a concern is not raised, you know, when a normal person is actually charged in the court or something. So why do you think, I mean, you talked about the celebrity status, but why can't the court even address the same kind of, a concern for a normal person who's charged with the same case? A same offense that maybe Aryan Khan or Sanjay that committed in the court. So what do you think about that? Why isn't the court, having that, rationality and stuff?
No, court does have that rational. They does keep that in mind, that how would the person be portrayed outside? Because if that would not have been the case, then the proceedings of any matter, for example, rape or murder would not have been going on for that long, and character would have been playing a very important role. But when I say that when they're dealing with celebrities, the concern that they have is how their fans would be treating that particular proceeding. How would their fans treat their idol? I would say idol. Idol is the correct word that is there, because sometimes there are people who are only fan for their work. Okay. Like, I also adore certain celebrities, but I only adore them as their screen presence, as how they're acting. But sometimes I would not like them as a person, but there are certain people who are blindly following these person, any celebrity for that matter, even sports person, director, actors. And they treat them as their idols. Okay. So it is actually something like if you are going against a religion, that is what I would be saying. So when I say that the courts need to be concerned, or they have this particular concern about how everything would come out to the fans, it is how they would be seeing their idol. That is what I meant. So even though courts have a concern for common people also, they have their rational in mind. They apply their judicial mind. Whatever it is written in the law, the applicability is actually same. But there's just one thing that in my opinion, it is there, that the courts are extra cautious
as they're handling a very sensitive issue.
Yeah.
I also had to ask, because WhatsApp was used as a major focal point for the prosecution to build their case. What do you think is the admissibility of these WhatsApp chats when you look at it from a legal point of view? So,
okay, so that is actually a very interesting thing. And there have been n number of cases. People have talked about it a lot, that whether they should be admissible in the court as an evidence or not.
Mm.
And that is what I would be talking about in the key, little bit of a legal aspect of it. So it was actually the statements of Aryan Khan that was made to the NCB officials. And in relying to those statements, they used the WhatsApp. So whatever WhatsApp thing was there, it was corroborating. It was used as a corroboration to the statements that were given by the Aryan Khan. And that is how the link was made. So talking briefly about this evidence aspect of it, the term that is used is actually circumstantial evidence.
Hmm.
So when there's no evidence as such in relation to a particular person, like in this case, clearly NCB has said that we did not find anything on Aryan Khan. So there was no evidence that was there. So then the next step goes in the procedure that they try to get statements, confessional statement from the accused itself. So they had extensive talks, had extensive interrogations with Aryan Khan, and being a human, he did say many things out. So now that particular statement, the confessional statement, would that be actually admissible in the court? No, it would not be admissible.
Only under a magistrate, if it's possible. It was only
exactly
under a magistrate.
So,
yeah.
Exactly. So it was given under like the NCB officials also come under the definition of police officers. Right. So that is why it was not admissible. Now, in order to make it admissible, they need to have it in corroboration with anything else. So they went on to find out about WhatsApp chats. And those WhatsApp chats were actually with the drug peddlers. Okay. So, but the main issue comes here. This is actually two issues. First, whether those particular WhatsApp chats have any connection with this case. And secondly, even if they have a connection, whether they have any evidentiary value or whether they are admissible or not. Okay. So, like whatever I said, it was reiterated in the case of Tufan Singh versus state of Tamil Nadu,
yeah,
where they said that the confessional statement made to the NCB officials are inadmissible by the virtue of Section 25 of Evidence Act, because they will be treated as a confessional statement made to police officers.
Yeah.
Then, there's another case, Shivraj versus Union of India, where the prosecution relied upon the voluntary statements made to the NCB officials. And in the same case, again, it was said that they could not rely on these statements. And these two cases were actually used by the Aryan Khan's lawyer to say that they cannot use the confessional statements of Aryan Khan. Now we come up to the second part, that is the evidentiary value of WhatsApp. Mm-hmm. Okay. So the court has relied upon the WhatsApp chats with the third person, that is the alleged drug peddler, to hold, only to hold, that Aryan Khan conspired with other illegal traffickers. Now, this is a very important thing. The WhatsApp chat did not reveal that he was actually selling, or that he was consuming, or that he was into this particular business. It only proved to the extent that he conspired. And that is made out of the chats, the way that they chatted. Okay. So with that, only the conspiracy theory was proven. And now the important thing is that WhatsApp chats are electronic evidence, and they would only be categorized as a secondary evidence if a certificate of Section 65B of Indian Evidence Act is produced. Okay. So it is a mandate that you need to put the certificate. That is the procedure that is there. Right. So if you have not followed that procedure, these WhatsApp chats would not be admissible. So if we talk clearly about evidentiary value and admissibility, they go hand in hand. So if I talk barely about admissibility of WhatsApp chats, yes, they can be admissible only if they are coupled with the certificate of 65B. If it is not coupled with 65B, it will not be admissible. And talking about the evidentiary value, they would have the evidentiary value if admitted just like a secondary evidence, not as a primary evidence, because it falls under the category of documentary secondary evidence only. So that would be the admissibility and the evidentiary value. Then there's like, I would write to quote a case. Actually, there are two cases. Arjun Khotkar versus Kailash Gurantia. That's a 2020 judgment, which reaffirmed the judgment of 2014. That was PV versus PK Bashir, where it was held that secondary evidence of electronic record would be inadmissible if not accompanied by a certificate stipulated under 65B.
That be used during a cross-examination as such, a WhatsApp chat.
Yeah, that can be used in the sense of corroboration. You can use it.
Okay.
So, like, if you submit a certificate, then that is an admissible piece of evidence. You can use it anywhere in the court proceedings.
Hmm.
So that is the major thing, that WhatsApp chats can be used. Like, I have also used them in the court proceedings. It can be used. But the important thing is, like, as I said in the just 2-3 minutes before also, that the WhatsApp chat only proved that there was a conspiracy, that he conspired.
Hmm.
So you can only prove and cross question and examine the witness as to the aspect of conspiracy. You cannot go beyond that, because that's not what WhatsApp chats are providing. So if you need to go beyond that, you need to prove a nexus. So that is the most important thing, that you need a certificate. And if you have a certificate, then they would be admissible. So that was the thing. But if we talk about the Aryan Khan case specifically, in that case, the WhatsApp chats did not have any evidentiary value because there was no proof of conspiracy. So you see what like how it happened in the Aryan Khan case and why it became such a big issue when the WhatsApp chats were introduced in the court. That you're saying that there was the WhatsApp chat proved conspiracy, and so WhatsApp chats have been introduced as an evidence. But when they were cross-questioning it, when they were presenting the evidence, it did not prove the conspiracy. So you see, so there was no evidentiary value, although they were admissible, but it did not have any evidentiary value. So that was with regard to the WhatsApp chats. So if
I would also give this other argument posed that, like you said, the WhatsApp chats only corroborate of some sort of conspiracy, but don't necessarily link towards possession of any sort of banned substance. So what do you, how do you think that would affect the proceedings that are going to take place?
That would definitely affect it, because the question comes in the conspiracy and the actual doing of the act. Okay. So there are, because in this case, there's not only Aryan Khan involved, there are other two people involved who were apparently held by the NCB and were found in possession of these drugs. So the direct case is against them. But just because, like, as I said previously also, because of this, maybe of the celebrity status, or for that matter, that he was somehow involved with those two people, Aryan Khan was roped in into the particular case. And that is why we are only hearing about Aryan Khan. We are not hearing about his friend. We are not hearing about the other person. Even we are talking about Aryan Khan today, but the both of them are out on bail. The court has given them bail, but not Aryan Khan. So definitely this particular thing of using of WhatsApp chat only for proving conspiracy and not anything else, or for providing corroboration, would be very effective in the future proceedings. Because now NCB would not be able to prove the fact of involvement of Aryan Khan other than conspiracy. That is the major thing. Because they have, now what NCB has done is they have themselves agreed, first of all, that there was nothing that we found on Aryan Khan. So that clearly negates his possibility with the consumption. There could be one thing where the medical test must have proved, and that's normal because Aryan Khan has been spotted in n number of parties. And many of us know that these celebrity kids, they may consume drugs. So that is a separate issue. If you talk about consumption, that is a separate issue. So maybe he would have consumed or not. That is his personal choice. But in regarding selling and in possession of drugs, NCB have themselves said that Aryan Khan was not doing any of these two things. So just to rope him in with the other perpetrators was only one angle of conspiracy. So now NCB is finding out how these things of conspiracy would be there. So one thing they did was corroborating it with the WhatsApp chats, but it was not, like, it was admissible, but it was not taken as an evidence and it did not prove conspiracy. So now maybe NCB would come up with another evidence. They'll try to get in more evidence, more testimonies. So maybe that would be that what would be we'll be seeing in the further case proceedings. So yeah, that was it.
And I think one last thing before we wrap up. This is also another argument posed that states that with the quantity that was allegedly found on Aryan Khan, the remedy available was rehab and not jail for that particular quantity. So what do you have to say about that?
Exactly. Yeah, this was the thing that we discussed before also, that the NDPS Act talks about three types of quantity. Small quantity, then there's commercial quantity, and the other one is more than small and less than commercial. So when there's a small quantity, then why they say that, why these three type of quantities are given? When it is small quantity, then there's a presumption, okay, that if you have a small quantity, then you are using it only for consumption, right? And it's a mental state that is seen of a person who is consuming a particular drug, that maybe he is doing it because of his own personal reasons, his own emotional reasons, own psychological reasons. So that is why, instead of making him a perpetrator or a criminal, first he's a victim. He has to be treated like a victim. That's why he has to go to rehab. First, we need to find out why he was why he was consuming those drugs. And then we'll see whether it comes out as an offense or not. And talking about the other two quantities, that is the commercial quantity and more than small quantity, then there's a presumption that if you're carrying such loads and loads of drugs, then you are not definitely going to consume it all by yourself. You're going it for selling, you're taking it for selling, or you're taking it for like a possession kind of thing. So that is why they would be treated as a criminal. They would be treated as a perpetrator. And that is why the punishments are different. And because of this differentiation, and because of the Aryan Khan case that came up with such a light and made an havoc, that the central government is thinking about scraping with the small quantity, the illegality of small quantity. They're thinking of making it legal to consume certain drugs, not all drugs. I'm again saying not all drugs, certain drugs. They're trying to make it legal if you're consuming it in small quantity, just like a liquor. So that would be the thing. And there was this argument that he would have been taken to rehab. That's a good argument. And that's actually what should have been done, prima facie. That he should have been taken to rehab or should have been taken to a psychologist to actually make things clear out that whether he only consumed it or not. But to be honest, NCB is taking it in the different angle that they're thinking that he is involved with the conspirators. And that may be the reason, because we are actually outsiders. We are only analyzing on what we are seeing on the news or internet. We don't know about the proceedings going on. We don't know about the in-depth knowledge. So that is what we are assuming, we are guessing. So yeah, that's what it is.
So I think with that being said, like also like sir mentioning on the pertaining aspect of rehab, and also about how far can the state criminalize with respect to small quantities, and also how we draw upon how WhatsApp can or cannot be used as an admissible evidence, and also how far does it prove to be a conspirator of sorts, and also hoping to see that at the court, and also how we as in the civil society react to such certain case and not promote a kind of media trial on certain individuals and declare them as India's Pablo Escobar of sorts. So with that being said, and hoping to look forward to greater sessions ahead, and thank you, sir, for spending your time with us, and also would I like to thank all my members as well for joining in the podcast, and do put forward your suggestions with regard to how you felt with regard to the session as such, and how the NDPS Act could possibly need a review of sorts, or as sir mentioned, how this center might bring about a different legislation in order to balance out certain things which might not stand a test of time. So according to you, do put forward in the comments as well. Until then, stay tuned to the next podcast by Argumenta Podcast. This episode will be available on Spotify, on YouTube, on IGTV as well. So do stay tuned to that. And thank you for watching. Stay tuned. Thank you.
Do like, share and subscribe to our channel on YouTube, and also follow our Instagram page with regard to regular updates as well.